for coming. I was just talking to Lauren, and it's interesting, most professors actually are fairly introverted, and we really don't like to talk in front of people, which seems sort of strange considering we get in front of the classroom all the time. But I think this is a really neat opportunity, and thank you for inviting me to come in. So some of you have had me for Franciscanism, some of you are in my class right now, and you know that I make you do an assignment where you put together scenes from your life. So there are what are known as docels from about St. Francis and St. Clair. So it has a central image of them, and then it's surrounded by images of specific and particular scenes from their life that had an impact on them. So for St. Francis, there's things about him embracing the leper, him meeting with the Sultan. So I have the students in my class put together their own scenes from the life assignment where they focus on the things that have made them who they are on their journey. So I figured it was only fair since I make them do it that I do it for them as well. So this is my scenes from the life, basically, my journey that I've been on. And I have a quote from Mary Oliver up at the top. Tell me then, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? I love Mary Oliver. She's a great poet, but everything that I read by her, there's some sort of element of wisdom or gem of knowledge that I get from what she's written. So on each of the slides that I have here, I have a quote from her as well. So all the quotes in here are from her. I'd like to take credit for them, but she wrote them all, so I have to give her credit for it. So the pictures kind of, I'll talk sort of about each one, and then because I could never decide which pictures to include, each slide has sort of more photos on it as well that relate to a particular kind of topic or aspect of my life. So I'll jump in. If anybody has any questions while I'm speaking, please feel free to raise your hand and let me know. I'm happy to answer them as we go along. So these are some pictures of my family. And yes, I included the little picture of me with my three brothers and Santa when I had sort of the bowl cut, haircut. My first communion picture with my godparents there. And then I have a couple pictures of me with my nieces, who are very important to me. I have three older brothers. I was the youngest of the three. So if you have older brothers, you know that that can be both torture and it can be extremely rewarding at the same time. So they were of the mindset that nobody else could pick on me, but they could constantly. So that was sort of what I grew up in. I had a dollhouse that I would set up very carefully with all the little furniture and dolls in it and so on, and my brothers would come along and there would be an earthquake, and they would shake the dollhouse and things would go flying all over the place. And so that was sort of the relationship that we had, where one minute we literally could be trying to kill each other, and then the next minute we would band together against whatever the sort of outside force was that we were fighting against. So that really taught me, one, to be tough. You can't grow up with three older brothers and not be tough, I think. But it also taught me the importance of having people that you can rely on and count on. So I know now as adults, and even as kids, I could go to my brothers for anything, and they would help me, and they would do what they could to help me make my way to survive whatever it was I needed, whether it was schoolwork, or I was having a problem with friends, or whatever. And I've tried to provide that for my nieces as well. So I have two nieces, they're both in college and graduate school now, but I try to be that support for them as well, because I think it's important that whatever we get, we try and give back as well and share with others. So this is probably one of the most formative things in everybody's life. Their family, who they grow up with, who they live with in those early years that sort of shape them in large part to be who they are. These are my parents. When I was 20 years old in college, probably about the same age that many of you are, my father died. He had been battling cancer for about a year. I was getting ready for my final exams. I had just had my 20th birthday, and I got a phone call in the evening that he had passed away. Obviously, that was a very difficult time in my life. It was difficult to kind of experience that as a 20-year-old, difficult to kind of try and focus on school while that was going on. And there were times when I thought I would not overcome that and would not be able to move beyond that. And so that was really hard for me. Having my brothers and my mother helped me immensely. You can't imagine the amount of support that they provided to me. But it also meant that I had to, I think at that moment was really the first time I felt like an adult in some ways, even though I was 20, because I was the one comforting my mother instead of the other way around. And there's a mark that's left on your heart when your parent dies. It's always there. You always miss them, but they're always there, and that's, I think, the important thing as well. About 3 years ago, so 30 years after my dad died, my mom passed away, and that was difficult as well. But I know that they're together. My mom loved to play cards, and I'm pretty sure the first thing she did when she got up to heaven was pulled out a deck of cards and started dealing them out with my dad. And I'm blessed that I have that much time with her in my life. We developed a really close relationship, and she is somebody who, both of my parents are people I try to model myself after and try to be like them in terms of how they acted. And what seemed to be and what was a tragedy in my life when my dad died led me in directions that I didn't know I would go in, but that ended up being really positive experiences for me as well, which I'll talk about in a minute or two. So again, that thing you think you can't overcome, you can. There are ways to overcome it with the help of friends, with support, and with strength, and we're usually a lot stronger than we think we are when we have to deal with some of these things. So I headed off to, was in college when I was getting ready to graduate. I went to Allegheny College, which is in Pennsylvania, a small liberal arts college. And when I got to college, people said, oh, what are you majoring in? I said, English. And people said, oh, you want to be a teacher. I said, oh, no, I don't want to teach. That's the last thing I want to do. I had no intention of teaching at all. I wanted to be a journalist. I wanted to write for a newspaper. And I did that. I got out of college, and I got a job working for a newspaper. My advisor when I was in college, though, had said to me, you know, you should think about teaching at the college level. I didn't even know that was a thing, really. I didn't know how you did that. The only thing I knew about teaching was you taught in a high school or elementary school. So that had been planted, that seed had been planted a little bit. But I still thought, no, I want to be a journalist, that's what I want to do. As I said, I worked for a small newspaper, I covered school board meetings and high school sports and things like that. Nothing really exciting, but I enjoyed it. I loved to write, so I enjoyed doing that. And then there was a news story that I was asked to cover that involved some students at the local high school on the night of their prom, the student driving a car, had been drinking. It was a horrible accident. Several of the students passed away as a result of the accident. It was my job as a reporter to go to the high school and talk to the students' friends about what had happened. And I understand the value of that. There's value in doing that and providing that news, but that moment made me realize that was not something I could do for the rest of my life. I don't have the right personality to do that. You have to be a little pushy and assertive to be a journalist. You have to be willing to kind of poke yourself into other people's lives. And I knew at that moment that that wasn't what I wanted to do, that I had to find a different path. That this path that I thought I had been on almost since I was about 6 or 7 years old, I wanted to be a writer. I had to readjust that. I had to figure out, so what do I do now? And in the back of my head, I heard my advisor's voice saying, graduate school, teaching at the college level. And I wasn't sure about that either. Because I didn't think teaching was what I wanted to do, but I kind of tried it out. I took a couple of classes at the graduate level, what they call non-matriculating, so not towards the degree. Finally decided, all right, I'm going to enroll full-time. Got a teaching assistantship. Walked into the classroom, and I knew at that moment that that was what I wanted to do with the rest of my life. So I had that experience of starting on one path and figuring out that's not where I need to be, and kind of adjusting and going to a different path. And I think we need to be open to that. We need to be open to the idea that we might have in our heads, this is where we're heading, might be a very different place that we end up. It's not always the same spot. So the sort of good thing, one of the good things that came out of my dad's death is after I graduated, I had worked for a few years, and I decided that I wanted to do something. I wanted to do some community service. I wanted to get involved with something as a way to sort of give back to the community. And I knew I wanted to do something related to cancer, to caring for cancer patients because of my experience with my dad. So I got involved with a great organization, Camp Good Days and Special Times. It's originated in Rochester, but they have offices in Buffalo and in Syracuse, and they provide services for kids affected by cancer. So for the most part, their mission is simply to try and let these kids have a good time. They don't focus on research, they don't focus on those types of things. It's just to have these kids have an opportunity to have some fun. So they have summer camp up on Cuca Lake in the Finger Lakes where the kids go for a week. You stay there with them in a cabin. They do rock climbing, they do fishing, they do tennis, they do baseball, basketball, whatever they want to do, basically. They get to be kids for that week. They don't have to think about going for treatment. They don't have to think about not feeling well. They don't have to worry about what other people are thinking about them. One of the greatest things that you see at a place like this is kids who are wearing hats because they've lost their hair. By the end of the week, they're running around with no hats on. They don't care, because that kid standing next to them doesn't have any hair either. Or that kid over there lost his hair and grew it back, and so they know what it feels like. So having that sort of connection, I think, is incredible. And these kids are so brave. They've taught me so much about courage, about bravery, but also about joy, about being willing to just be a kid, no matter how old you are. So we sing silly songs, we go to the costume barn and wear outfits, and it's just a chance to really sort of be in that moment with them and to embrace that childlike spirit that they have and that joy that they have. And that's been something I've been doing for over 20 years now. So some of the kids that I worked with when they were 4 or 5 years old, they're in their 20s now, they're serving as volunteers. Some of them actually, there have been a few who have been at Hilbert College and have graduated from here. So they've had this wonderful opportunity to live their lives when early on they thought they might not have it. And they've taught me more than I could ever give to them in terms of the experience and so on that I have from them. So that again, something that started very negative for me, the death of my father turned into something that's really important to me and that continues to be part of my life and part of sort of who I am as a person. I also travel a lot. Many of you know that. I've talked with you about sort of places we've gone and so on. Sometimes it's with students as part of the honors program or service trips, and sometimes it's on my own. So these are a few of the pictures I have up here. I think travel is really important for a lot of different reasons. In large part for me, it's about having an openness to different cultures and different places and different people. So you meet so many different people and have the opportunity to experience so many different things through travel. So I just want to share a couple stories. The picture in the middle there is from Hiroshima, Japan. I had a roommate when I was in college who was Japanese, and she went back to Japan after she graduated, and I went there and visited her with a friend of mine. And one of the opportunities we had was to go to Hiroshima, where during World War II, one of the atomic bombs was dropped. And we had this incredible experience of being escorted or sort of being given a tour by this woman who had actually been in Hiroshima when the atomic bomb was dropped. She was one of the, they were known as the Hiroshima Maidens. They had suffered horrible burns on their bodies as a result of the radiation and were brought to the United States for treatment. She went back then to Japan and actually worked at the Peace Museum in Hiroshima. So walking around with her, it was sort of a surreal experience. We'd be walking and just sort of chit-chatting about things, and she would stop and say, this is where my brother was standing when the atomic bomb was dropped, or this is where my father died, or whatever. But the amazing thing was she wasn't bitter about it. She wasn't angry about it. She had an amazing ability to forgive. And she was working for the Peace Museum in part because she wanted people to be able to have that sense of forgiveness and understanding of other people's perspectives. And I think that really had a powerful impact on me, to listen to her and her ability to forgive and to accept what had happened to her and to work to promote peace, that became sort of the message of her life. How can you kind of build peace after such a horrific experience? So that was one of the first trips I took sort of as an adult, kind of on my own, without my family and so on, and it was a very meaningful one for me. Just as a little aside, I have a picture there of a sloth, which was from Costa Rica. We were all on a bus, and it was a small bus with our tour group, and the bus driver said, oh, there's a sloth, do you want to see it? And we all go running off the bus and running up the road to see it, and then I thought, it's a sloth, why are we running? It's not like it's going to outrun us. So, but that was neat too. So again, a lot of different experiences, all of which have given me an opportunity to see new things, experience new things, and really be open to them and open to trying new things. Yes, ma'am?
I just want to know.
Yeah, so that's from Northern Ireland, from Belfast. So there was a lot of violence in Northern Ireland between the Catholics and the Protestants, and the city is really still pretty much, there's literally a wall that runs through it. One side is Catholic, the other side is Protestant. On the Catholic side, they've painted all of these murals in honor of people who died. So that is Bobby Sands, who was arrested, put into prison, and actually died on a hunger strike. He starved himself to death, basically, to protest the treatment of the Catholics in Belfast. So again, a lot of history, a lot of interesting experiences. This is CC up there? So that's the St. Francis, Cathedral St. Francis up there at the top. If you ever get the chance, go. It's one of the most beautiful places in the world and one of the most peaceful places in the world as well. So travel is important, and sort of the expansion, I guess, of travel is some of the service work that I've done in other places. So I talked about working with Camp Good Days, which is really important, but I've also had the opportunity to go abroad and travel and do service work there as well. So a couple of the pictures are from service trips I've done with Hilbert students to Kenya. Some of you here are going with me next time in May. So, and it's an incredible opportunity, and it is an opportunity and experience that makes me so grateful for what I have. But that also makes me recognize the privilege that I have simply by being born where I was born. So we work with children with disabilities when we're in Kenya, and there's still a lot of stigma around that there. So one of the guys we were with was telling us a story about a child who had some developmental delays. And because they don't really have the same level of knowledge or the same resources that we have, especially in remote areas, they think some of these things are caused by witchcraft and things like that. The child was literally chained up to a tree because they didn't know what to do with him. They didn't know how to care for him. They were afraid of him. And that makes me so sad that because that child was born there, he doesn't have the same opportunities that a child born in the United States would have. Through no fault of that child's own, it's just where he was born. And I think we all need to be conscious of that, that where we are plays a large role in who we become. And being born in the United States, although everybody has their difficulties and challenges, we have some privileges and things that we're able to do that people in other parts of the world can't even consider doing or don't ever have the opportunity to even think about. So doing some of this service work has really made me conscious of that. And conscious also, though, again, of sort of the spirit of joyfulness. So we spend a lot of time with kids. They're super happy. They love playing with you. They love having their picture taken and then looking at their picture. They love any attention that you can give to them. And I think that's almost sort of a universal. It doesn't really seem to matter where you are. The last time that we were in Kenya, we built beds because some of the kids stay in the school. And the boys' side didn't have any beds, so the kids were sleeping on the floor. So we built beds for them, gave them beds, mattresses, and they immediately started to jump on the bed. So I think that's a universal. Kids just everywhere will jump on beds the minute they get them. But they were so happy to have a space of their own, that they could call their own, that was their own spot. They didn't have to worry about sleeping on the floor. So those simple things, again, that we sometimes take for granted, doing things like this helps me to remind me of why I should be grateful for what I have, and also hopefully what I can do to help alleviate other people's misfortune or other people's suffering. So that's been a great opportunity, and again, has really, I think, shaped who I am as a person and how I try to live my life and what I try to sort of focus on and give to others as well. So that's a big part of who I am, too. And then I also, I love being outside. I love being outdoors and immersing myself in nature. I like to go by myself a lot, so there's always a sign at the beginning of the trail, do not hike alone, and I just sort of ignore that usually and hike alone. But I think there's so much beauty out there that we frequently just don't see because we don't give ourselves the opportunity to do it. So I like to do some hiking when I can. Some of that is through my travels, some of it is just taking an opportunity to have some solitude and some quiet, and I think it helps to kind of regenerate and renew people as well, to have that experience and so on. It's easy to get caught up in sort of the chaos of our lives, and I think for me anyway, being in nature is a way for me to get away from that, and to sort of simplify things, but also to think about the grandeur of what's in front of us that we sometimes miss or don't see because we're not looking in the right direction. So that's really important as well. I did some hiking this summer. There's this series of peaks in the Adirondacks called the Saranac Six, which you can climb. And so the one in the middle is from the top of one of those, and somebody said, "Oh, you look very sad and peaceful." I said, "Well, you should have seen me when I was going uphill. I wasn't so sad and peaceful then." But it is, there is a feeling of accomplishment as well when you sort of get to the top of that hill, literally and figuratively, I think. So it's a good kind of reminder of again, the ability to overcome challenges and to sort of hike up those hills and get to where you need to be. And then I think this is, I think I have one more slide, but this is the one with the most pictures on it. So these are some of my work friends. So I have a couple on here. These are Hilbert folks. It's a little sad because many of them are no longer at Hilbert, so that's a little sad for me to look at that. But I wanted to focus on this for a couple of reasons. The picture in the middle there, some of you know Professor Griffin, I'm sure. Some of you might remember Dr. Holloman. I had the great privilege of going on a pilgrimage with them to Assisi and Rome, which was a wonderful experience. So that picture is from that. But I wanted to include that picture for a couple of reasons. One, because Professor Griffin has become one of my best friends, which you kind of don't really expect. I think after a certain period of your life, you kind of have your friends and that's it. But I'm fortunate and blessed to have Professor Griffin as a good friend to me, and we've continued our friendship even though she's moved on to other things. But Dr. Holloman also had a big impact on me. One of his favorite sayings is, "Err on the side of grace," right? Meaning kind of give people the benefit of the doubt, don't think the worst of them, err on the side of grace. And I think that that's something that I try and remember and kind of keep in my heart as well. It's easy to sort of jump to conclusions, to jump to the worst possible idea, to not give people the benefit of the doubt. But I think it's important that we try and do that, that we try and give people the benefit of the doubt, that we err on the side of grace until we know differently. Right? Think the best of people instead of thinking the worst. And that, again, can be difficult sometimes. I was reminded of that this morning when somebody cut me off on the road and I didn't have any nice things to say about the person at that time. But you want to do that, I think, as much as you can. And so I try to sort of live by that principle as well. And then, again, just the idea that I think, you know, if we think about how we are blessed and the blessings that we have in our lives, there's a lot of them, right? And sometimes it's just sort of paying attention to them and seeing them around us. So for me, at Hilbert, a lot of that comes from the friends that I have here and that I've made. But there's a lot of other ways that we can kind of, again, sort of stand and look around us and see the blessings and see how we are part of this world. And then I'm going to conclude with this this quote, which is from, again, a Mary Oliver poem that's sort of about how you die in a way, right? And what you want your death to be like. So she ends the poem by saying, "When it's over, I don't want to wonder if I have made of my life something particular and real. I don't want to find myself sighing and frightened or full of argument. I don't want to end up simply having visited this world." And again, that's something that I try to sort of live by. I try to sort of immerse myself in the world to make sure that I'm engaging with people, engaging with things, that I'm not sort of cutting myself off, that I'm not just sort of a visitor here and not really playing a role in what's happening. And the last picture there is, I actually found that rock when I was doing the Outdoor Nation Challenge and took a walk at Stiglmayer Park in Cheektowaga, if any of you know that. And it's kind of a thing now. People will paint rocks and they'll write phrases on it and leave them in different places for other people to find. And so I found this rock that said, "Be the change you wish to see in the world." And so I thought that that was a good picture to include to sort of end the presentation. Again, good words to live by, right? That if we want a different world, we should be the first ones to mirror that world, right? Mirror the world that we want to see to be the people that we want others to be as well. So I think that that's a really important thing to me, and that relates to that idea of not simply visiting this world, that we all have a role to play and we all have a responsibility to ourselves and to others in terms of how we act, how we behave, how we treat others. And so I think for me those are sort of some simple kind of messages or ideas that I try and kind of keep close to me to remind myself of that when it's easy to think about other things and get caught up in other issues and so on. And I think that is, so that's it.
Just wanted to ask if anybody has a question for Dr. Smith that you'd like to ask. Floor is yours.
Yes, Cameron.
What is your favorite memory from any of your trips? Or if you have a couple to share?
I actually think the bed ones with the kids jumping on the beds, that was one of the favorite ones. We had heard this story about one of the boys who was living in this dormitory. He would actually take his stuff, so they had like a blanket for him and stuff, and he would sneak into, there was a school next door to it, he would go into the shed of the groundskeeper of the school next door and sleep there because it was more comfortable there than sleeping in the dormitory on the floor. And so he actually said to one of the people that we were working with something to the effect of, now I don't have to go over there to sleep, I can sleep here in my own bed. So that's definitely one of the things that sort of sticks with me a lot. Another memory, it's not, I don't know that it's a fond memory, but it sticks out in my mind. The first year we went to Kenya, we were working with a school, and it was a sort of like a nursery school or a preschool. So it was run by a church, and the pastor of the church said, I'd like to give you something to thank you. We raise ducks here. I'm going to give you two ducks that you can take back to the families that you're staying with to cook for dinner or whatever. So I said, okay, whatever. I'm like, I don't know. So we leave, and I thought, all right, well, he forgot about the ducks or whatever, not a big deal. We come back, and the car shows up a few minutes later, and they come out, and they say, the ducks are in the back of the car. So, like, oh, okay. You know, I'm thinking Wegman's duck, right? It's dead. It's going to be in a package or whatever. I open up the back of the truck. There's two live ducks sitting there. And I'm like, I don't know what to do with those. So they're like, well, take one to, you know, the woman whose house you're staying in, and then one to the woman across the way where some other people were staying. So me, never having held a duck before, right, I go to pick it up and, like, cradle it like a baby, and they're like, no, you don't hold a duck like that. You grab the wings so that the wings don't flap or whatever. And, all right, so there's actually a picture of me, like, going like this, carrying the duck because I didn't know how else to do it. But that became our dinner that night. That's what we had for dinner. So it gives you a different sense of farm to table, I guess, when you're actually when they're actually slaughtering the duck in the yard behind your house or whatever. So those two stick out. But there's been lots of really wonderful memories, and some of my favorite memories from traveling with students on some of the honors trips is seeing their excitement about seeing places as well. So we went to Paris and saw the Eiffel Tower at night. It was all lit up, and just sort of watching their amazement, I think, and their enjoyment of it is a really neat experience for me, especially if it's a place I've been before. I kind of get to see it new through their eyes if it's new for them. Yeah, Ren?
Do you have any favorite trails?
Any favorite trails? No, I mean, I do a lot of walking. I'm not sure they're really trails because they're pretty well maintained. But Stiglmayer Park has some nice walking trails. I've actually had quite a few wildlife encounters there with deer and raccoon. And raccoon during the day, that afterwards I thought that's probably not good that it's out during the day. But that's a very nice, it's close, but it's a nice peaceful spot as well. Like, you really do sort of feel like you're someplace else because you can't hear any of the traffic noise or anything. And there are some trails there that are a little remote along a stream, which is really nice as well. Some of the ones I did in the Adirondacks were really nice. Again, part of what I like is that some of them are not super busy, so you don't really see a lot of other people, which for me is, I like that when I'm outside in nature. I don't like to talk to other people when I'm outside, I guess. I like to have sort of some private time or whatever.
Thank you.
my goal. I honestly don't know. I'd have to count them up. I guess I believe there's always some new place to explore. And I like to travel everywhere, so I travel in the United States as well. But I kind of feel like later on when I'm a little bit older, it'll probably be better for me to stay closer to home, so I'd rather do the far away trips now. So I've done some really far away, so Australia and Japan are probably the furthest two that I've gone. But every place I think is neat. Every place has some place to offer, something to offer.
What's your
favorite place? That's a tough question. I don't know. I really love Ireland. I've been there a few times, and I really like the people there. It's a very warm, friendly environment. And Australia was really neat just because it's different. And I got to hold a koala and stuff, so that was cool. So I think that also, I learned a lot about sort of the Aboriginal people there, which was neat too to learn about that.
Any other questions? I kind of have one. So, you know, traveling everywhere, seeing so many things, someone who likes to explore, and yet, you're here, you know, you're in Buffalo, you're in Hilbert. What's kept you, despite your desire to go everywhere, what's ultimately kept you here?
Well, I guess the cynical answer is a job. So. that's sort of interesting. When you get your PhD in a lot of fields, you kind of know you're going to have to go wherever the job is. Like, you can't say, well, I want to stay in Buffalo because that's where my family is. So the first job I got actually was at Elmira College, which wasn't too far from home, but in kind of the southern tier. But I sort of figured, one, I wasn't going to stay there a long time. It wasn't the perfect job for me. And I had sort of resigned myself to the idea of I might have to move, you know, wherever to work, to do what I wanted to do. And again, I guess the way in which we are led down paths that we don't expect, Hilbert happened to have a job opening. I applied. They foolishly hired me then, and they haven't been able to get rid of me since, so I've been here for over 20 years now. And I think that for me, I love traveling, but I also love having sort of a home base. And for me, that home is also connected to family. It's connected to some of the stuff that I do with Camp Good Days. It's, you know, you create a life, I think, where you feel at home. And for me, that's here. I don't know if it would be someplace else if I have that same sense someplace else. And Buffalo has so much to offer that, you know, we'd want to stay here.
Very cool. How about another round of applause?